वी कैन नॉट कीप सिटिंग ऑन अ हाई हॉर्स एंड से ओके ये सब तो हम से नीचे हैं, ये सब जमीन पर कीड़े चल रहे हैं, हम तो घोड़े पर बैठे हैं, ऐसा कैसे हो सकता है।
I assume you have spent considerable number of years in Allahabad.
Yes, of course. I grew up there.
You grew up there. So yeah. How do you carry that? You know, it's people from Allahabad, we know that they're irresistible about that old tradition, cultural, literary, that whole thing goes into personality making. So how do you carry it in your academic endeavors?
Allahabadi culture is very special, and anyone who grows up in Allahabad carries that culture with him or her. And in my case, I was doubly fortunate because I belong to a literary family, and growing up, I witnessed so many writers were coming into our house, and I was sitting in their laps. You know, जैसे महादेवी वर्मा जी की गोद में मैं बैठी हूँ और पता नहीं फिर आप गोरखपुरी की गोद में तो नहीं देखे उनसे बहुत बार मुलाकात हुई, और आप समझ लीजिए जो हमारे फादर के जो कंटेम्प्रेरीज हैं जैसे शहरयार और इस तरह के जो और एमिनेंट शायर हैं, उन सबको हम लोग चचा कहते थे, अब तो वो लोग भी गुजर गए। सो इलाहाबाद का एक अड्डेबाजी वाला कल्चर है, वहाँ पर कॉफी हाउस में सारे लोग बैठक बाजियाँ होती हैं वहाँ, और कुछ खास वोकैबुलरी भी है जो इलाहाबाद से जुड़ी हुई है। मसलन अबे कहना बहुत आई मीन इट्स मोर ऑफ मैस्कुलिन थिंग, लेकिन देयर इज अ सर्टेन अबे तबे का कल्चर इन इलाहाबाद। So I never actually let go my connection with Allahabad, and I think it was because of the pull of my parents, and also I was fortunate, like aap hain Sushil ji, aap bhi comparative literature mein hain, toh main bhi comparative literature mein hoon, aur mera chunke area of work hamesha Urdu aur Hindi raha, isliye mujhe jo fellowships bhi milti thi wo bahar baar baar ghar hi jaane ke liye milti thi। तो इस तरह से मैंने मेरा रिश्ता इलाहाबाद से कभी भी वो नहीं हुआ, अलग नहीं हुआ।
So related to that, actually, when you were spending your childhood there, you had exposure to literary figures who were doing Hindi literature, Urdu poetry. Your father himself was well versed in variety of literary traditions.
Yes.
There was no exclusion of one tradition in preference for another tradition. This was like real amalgamation of literary traditions that you grew up with. So in that context, I wanted to hear from you whether that also shaped your interest in the idea of literary culture, and how did you configure that idea of literary culture?
Okay, this is a very good question, and it has many levels to it. So let me try to answer it as best as I can. So first thing is that me and my sister, we both went to an English medium school. And in school, in those days, they were very strict enforcing that the students should speak only in English. And Hindi was offered as a subject, but at a much lower level. It was called elementary Hindi. And so my parents, especially my father, he was very particular that we should learn Urdu, Hindi, Persian also, Farsi, at home. And arrangements were made there were people who came to teach us. But also my parents themselves, they took time off from their busy work schedule, and they would always sit down and make sure that we were reading the right kind of literature. So my education was very different from that of my peers and my friends in school, because I was way ahead in literary, for example, I was only in the, I must have been like 9 or 10 years old, and I had memorized a lot of poetry in Urdu and Hindi. And in English, of course, we had to memorize poems in school, so I knew all that. So it was like a three-pronged approach, and also Farsi. I didn't memorize that much Farsi, but I was taught how to be able to read, and you know, of course, the script is the same. So and the atmosphere at home was so steeped in literature that it just became a part of my life. And in some ways it was very good, but in some ways it was also not so good, because if you read too much poetry, you begin to live in a kind of an alternate reality, which is, you know, the world of the ghazal,
right,
in which everything happens in extremes. You know, there is the lover, there is the beloved, there's the sheikh, there is the, you know, there's the mehkhana, and you internalize all that and you start thinking in extremes, which is what began to, I think, affect me quite a bit, because I felt that I was slightly, you know, I was in another reality compared to my peer group. And it was something that also made me very rebellious, and it made me think independently. That was something that my parents had encouraged, but they didn't realize that it would lead me into being my own person so much that it didn't fit in with the archetypical Indian family pattern where daughters are supposed to obey all the time. And so this was the result of it.
मैं इससे एक पूछना चाह रहा था, क्योंकि आपने वो उसी से थ्रेड मिलता है कि जैसे शमसुर साहब ने, शमसुर रहमान फारूकी साहब ने मीर पर काम किया, वो चाहते तो आपको फोर्स कर सकते थे कि भाई मीर पर ही काम कर लो या वर्क, बट यू चूज टू वर्क ऑन काले. सो हाउ दैट हैपेंड एंड वाज दैट एनी काइंड ऑफ लाइक, वो कैसे आपने तय किया कि भाई गालिब पर करेंगे, जबकि आपके पिताजी का इतना बड़ा काम है जिसमें बहुत काम और हो सकता है.
देखिए, वो लोग कभी हमें कंपेल नहीं करते थे किसी चीज़ को करने के लिए. वो उन्होंने काफ़ी खुली छूट दे रखी थी कि आपका जो दिल चाहे आप कीजिए, आप अपने आप सवाल उठाइए. तो शुरू में, क्योंकि वो खुद भी गालिब ही की तरफ, उनकी अगर आप उनका अर्ली वर्क देखिए तो वो गालिब से ही शुरू होता है. उन्होंने 1968 में से शुरू किया तफहीम गालिब, विच इज़ अ कॉमेंट्री ऑन गालिब, और वो 69 में गालिब की सेंचुरी मनाई गई थी, तो उस सिलसिले में उन्होंने ये कॉलम शुरू किया था शबखोन में लिखना. एंड बाद में वो किताब की तरह बन गया, उसमें उन्होंने एडिशंस किए. तो गालिब की तरफ वो शुरू से ज़्यादा, और गालिब पर उन्होंने शुरू में बहुत लिखा है. और गालिब की जो कॉम्प्लेक्सिटीज़ थी समहाउ वो मुझे भी अपील करती थी. और बाद में जब मैंने यहाँ पढ़ाना शुरू किया, तो शुरू में मुझे पढ़ाना तो यहाँ मॉडर्न लिटरेचर होता था, बिकॉज उसी के लिए ज़्यादा स्टूडेंट्स इंटरेस्टेड रहते हैं. तो मॉडर्न लिटरेचर जब मैं पढ़ाने लगी, तो मुझे ये एहसास हुआ कि मैंने बहुत कम पढ़ा था मॉडर्न लिटरेचर उर्दू में. हालांकि सेकेंड हैंड नॉलेज मुझे बहुत थी, लेकिन फर्स्ट हैंड जैसे कि बाकायदा स्टडी करना वो मैंने नहीं किया था. तो फिर मैंने पहले मॉडर्न लिटरेचर पढ़ा, और मेरी किताब है दो वॉल्यूम्स में, एंथोलॉजी ऑफ मॉडर्न उर्दू लिटरेचर, ऑक्सफोर्ड से पब्लिश हुई. तो तब मैंने एक तरह से पीएचडी अपने को किया इन मॉडर्न उर्दू. लेकिन मेरा जहन जो था वो हमेशा क्लासिकल गज़ल की तरफ मायल था. आई वॉज ऑलवेज ड्रॉन टू द क्लासिकल गज़ल एंड इट्स पोएटिक्स एंड इट्स वर्ल्ड, यू नो, इट्स द वर्ल्ड ऑफ द गज़ल, जिसमें कि गोलो बुलबुल के का जो किस्सा है, और जो जो वो सारी चीज़ें मुझे बहुत अट्रैक्ट करती थी हमेशा. मैंने कभी उनसे ये राय नहीं ली, ना उन्होंने मुझसे कहा कि तुम गालिब पे काम करो. बस मैं, मेरे एक तरह से वो हुआ ये कि फ्रांसिस प्रिचेट, जो जिनकी कमेंट्री है गालिब पर अंग्रेजी में, शी वॉज अबाउट टू रिटायर एंड देर वॉज अ कॉन्फ्रेंस इन हर ऑनर. तो मुझसे कहा गया कि यू नो, यू वुड यू लाइक टू प्रेजेंट अ पेपर, एंड मैंने कहा हाँ. And I thought that I should, you know, because her work is on Ghalib, I should present on Ghalib. So I thought, you know, Ghalib par itna kaam ho chuka hai, what will I be able to say? And then I began to think of my childhood, and my father had made me memorize some verses. And then he had told me that this is from Ghalib's Mustarad Kalam. And I said, Mustarad kya hota hai? And he told me, Mustarad are those verses which have been rejected by the poet. He didn't include them in his Diwan. So wo cheez mujhe meri zehen mein thi. And then, so maine socha ki, let me write a paper on the Mustarad. And I thought ki honge 50-100 verses mujhe mil jayenge, main us pe karungi. But when I started looking at it, I realized that there were more than 2,000, and it's more than half of Ghalib's poetry. So that was the beginning of my interest, was actually through his unpublished or rejected verses. And that's how I, that was my path to coming towards Ghalib. And I wrote that paper, and it was much appreciated. And it was kind of, I then decided to continue. And I then began to have so many questions. And the biggest question was, why did he decide not to use those verses? Were they bad? Were they not up to the standard? And then I found that many of them, not all of them, of course, some of them were too obscure. And they were too, it wasn't, you know, there was, jaise bemaza kuch the. So it made sense, at least maybe for 1/3 of those. But then why do that? And, you know, why not let the readers decide what is good, what is bad? Why become your own editor? Because Ghalib was his own editor. He didn't ask anyone to come and help him edit his verses.
Right.
He did it by himself. So in that process, it was very personal. Many of the things that he took out should have been included. And I began to discover that. The other thing that I found out was that print, you know, the printing press was, it was that period of time. And so Ghalib went to Calcutta for his pension, but there he found that the world of printing and publishing was very strong. And so he made this decision that he should publish his work. And because he had a reputation of being difficult, he thought, you know, maybe if I'm going to publish all these difficult verses, who's going to read this? So he made this decision to make a selection, jisko hum intikhab kehte hain. To unhone intikhab kiya. And jisko hum Diwane Ghalib kehte hain, actually, it is an intikhab Ghalib done by himself. And then when my father found, we shared the conversation, and when he saw that I was heading in this direction, he was very pleased. He said that, "Haan, you're meri beti ho, tabhi tum nahi nahi sawal pooch rahi ho." So he was really delighted that I was going in that direction and encouraged me.
I'm sure you must be thinking about Ghalib even now, and there must be possibility of framing new questions.
Right, right. Actually, I'm doing the second book on Ghalib.
So what are the new questions one would toy with?
Okay, so one of the questions, which is that when you look at how he did his selections, okay? So let's say there is one ghazal and it consists of 9 verses and he takes out 6 for selection and he rejects 3. Or he adds more verses. So then I began to think that why does he add the verses at a certain number? You know, I mean, we know that a ghazal has a first, you know, matla or maqta hota hai. The first verse hota hai. Wo ye obvious kar deta hai ki yahan se shuru ho rahi hai poem. Aur jo last hota hai, usme generally poet apna naam dal dete hain taki pata chal jaye ki yahan par khatam ho rahi hai. Each ke jo verses hain, uske baare mein generally ye opinion hai ki you can change the order of those verses. And that is because in a ghazal, every verse is complete. Her sher jo hai wo apne aap mein ek mukammal hasti hai. Lekin I disagreed with this. Maine jab ye dekha, jab maine Ghalib ko itne manuscripts maine dekhe aur maine itni gaur se usko jab study kiya, to maine dekha ki jab Ghalib ne additions kiye hain, to ek certain number pe kiye hain. Place kiya hai sher ko number 3 pe, number 7 pe. Aisa kyun kiya hai? Agar ye koi order nahi hota, to wo इसके बारे में क्यों परवाह करते? वो लास्ट में जो नए वर्सेस हैं वो लास्ट में ऐड कर देते, हो गया. इसी तरह से मैंने ये भी देखा कि द उर्दू दीवान जिसको हम कहते हैं, बहुत से लोगों को नहीं मालूम कि व्हाट इज द मीनिंग ऑफ अ दीवान एंड हाउ इट इज डिफरेंट फ्रॉम द टर्म मजमुआ. मजमुआ मीन्स अ कलेक्शन ऑफ पोएम्स एंड दीवान ऑल्सो मीन्स अ कलेक्शन ऑफ पोएम्स, बट इट इज अ कलेक्शन ऑफ पोएम्स दैट इज ऑर्गेनाइज अल्फाबेटिकली. दिस वॉज अ रिमार्केबल थिंग दैट आई टुक होल्ड ऑफ.
Yeah, we just think
So
it's an anthology.
yeah, we all even I used to think like that, but then I found this out because मेरे ज़हन में ये सवाल उठा, क्योंकि जब मैंने पढ़ना शुरू किया तो मैंने देखा कि साहेब दीवान, जो शायर साहेब दीवान हो जाता था, यानी उसकी एक स्टैंडिंग हो जाती थी, मतलब इट वॉज लाइक अ सर्टिफिकेट कि आप साहेब दीवान हैं. इसका मतलब ये होता था कि वो जो उर्दू की जो अल्फाबेट है उसके हर अल्फाबेट के रदीफ में उन्होंने शेर कहे हैं. यू नो रदीफ इज द एंड वर्ड, जैसे कि दिल नादान तुझे हुआ क्या है इसमें, है यानी ये इज द लास्ट अल्फाबेट. तो अलिफ बे ते से सारे जो अल्फाबेट्स हैं उसकी एंडिंग्स पे आपने शेर कह दिए हैं, तब आप साहेब दीवान हो गए. तो अगर आप दीवान उठाइए तो इट इज ऑर्गेनाइज लाइक अलिफ बे, यू नो. सो ऑब्वियसली जैसे जब हम अंताक्षरी खेलते हैं या हम बैतबाजी करते हैं तो ई और इससे बहुत सारे यू नो एंडिंग्स होती हैं. सो यू नो दैट द मैक्सिमम ऑफ नंबर ऑफ वर्सेस आर गोइंग टू बी इन अलिफ एंड इन ये और ई, एंड दे आर फ्यूअर इन बे जे, यू नो लाइक दैट. सो दे आर सम दैट यू जस्ट कैनॉट कम अप विद अ वर्स. So Ghalib had to do this as well in order to have a Diwan. But I found that within the categories, like Alif, for instance, जैसे आया, आना, इससे एंड हो रहा है, तो उसमें जो ऑर्गेनाइजेशन है वो काफी विम्सिकल है, वो इतना ज्यादा वो नहीं है, उसमें कोई ऐसे स्ट्रिक्ट रूल्स नहीं है. तो उससे ये समझ में आता था कि उसके अंदर भी एक सर्टन ऑर्डर है कि ये गजल मुश्किल है, इसको एक आसान गजल के बाद रखो, या ये रोमांटिक है तो इसको एक सैड के बाद, उसके बाद रखो. दीज आर वेरी फाइन थिंग्स दैट आई बिगेन टू डिस्कवर बिकॉज आई मेरी मेरी जो रीडिंग थी वो इतनी क्लोज हुई ना, बिकॉज आई हैड टू डू दिस इन ऑर्डर टू अंडरस्टैंड. देन आई बिगेन टू डिस्कवर दीज थिंग्स एंड सो माई सेकेंड बुक इज basically looking at my own selection of those verses that Ghalib rejected. So I've done kind of a hyper selection, and then I am going to make this argument for every ghazal. I'm trying to look at the ghazal as a whole, not as made up of pieces, and I'm trying to see how Ghalib's mind, editorial mind, was working when he was constructing a new ghazal from existing ghazals, because that's what he was doing, taking out verses from one and putting them in another place, that's what he was doing. So I am looking at these questions, plus I have done a commentary on my selected, I've chosen about 40 ghazals and it comes to 500 plus verses, and then I have a, in my commentary I make arguments about every ghazal. ऐसा क्यों है कि इसको उन्होंने क्यों नहीं लिया, और यहाँ पर उनको ये ले लेना चाहिए था, ये शेर ऐसा क्यों किया उन्होंने. तो काफी मजा आ रहा है सब
हाँ,
करने
गालिब की खूबसूरत वो दुनिया से थोड़ा हटके मेरा एक आई हैड दिस वेरी टिपिकल ऑफ अ सोशल साइंस पर्सन अ क्वेश्चन अबाउट सर्टन काइंड ऑफ कैटेगरीज व्हिच आर ऑफ्टन यूज्ड एम्प्लॉयड इन लिटरेरी स्टडीज सोशियोलॉजिस्ट एंथ्रोपोलॉजिस्ट यूजुअली आई मीन लार्ज चंक ऑफ देम आर नॉट इंटरेस्टेड Or they don't have time to take interest in literary materials, but unlike that mainstream sociology, I happen to be a wayward, and therefore I look at this particular terminology which has been employed several times in most of the studies, which is vernacular modernity. And when we hear of vernacular modernity, स्पेसिफिकली विद इन रिलेशन विद अ पर्टिकुलर लैंग्वेज. सो वी हियर ऑफ वर्नाक्युलर मॉडर्निटी इन अ लैंग्वेज, वी रेयरली हियर ऑफ वर्नाक्युलर मॉडर्निटी इन लैंग्वेजेस. सो बिकॉज literary culture of a language will be crisscrossing with literary culture of several other languages. So why not speak of vernacular modernity of languages? This seems to be some kind of axiomatic usage in literary studies. Axiomatic in the sense that you just say vernacular modernity in Hindi literature and you just look at materials which are related to Hindi literary studies and not look at other kind of literary materials, other kind of literary cultures. I mean, we don't see majority of scholars who would be looking at Hindi literary culture engaging with Urdu literary culture or Persian literary culture, or for that matter even Avadhi or local Bhojpuri literary culture or Maithili literary culture. So how does it really happen, this kind of streamlined, very clear path?
So what my approach to vernacular modernity was through the capability of the language to be able to process abstract ideas. So we know that our classical languages, Sanskrit, the mother language, is very advanced in literary theory and has all the tools like, you know, dhwani and all those other literary devices that one uses to understand poetry in particular, because Mahakavya. The same goes for Arabic and Persian. These are also classical languages that have developed a very high literary paraphernalia to assess literary production. Now, when we look at the modern languages, which are not, don't have such a deep history, like Urdu, Hindi. Urdu, Hindi is the same origins. And of course, Avadhi, Bhojpuri, they're all linked together. So they also began mostly as languages of poetry. And they moved, some of them didn't really move towards prose until much, much later. Prose requires, for example, it requires abstraction, the tools of language having the capability to grab abstract ideas, so and be able to be create a prose narrative, which is critical. And I found that in Urdu that was lagging behind, and also in Hindi, and both these languages tended to fall back on their classical sisters or mothers like Sanskrit and Arabic, Persian in Urdu, for the vocabulary. At present, the situation is that we are falling back on English more and more for our vocabulary needs. And even when we have the words available to us, even when we have the synonyms available to us in our own language, we are lazy and we don't want to use them. Also, we have lost the capability of writing in a register that is at once a literary register, but also a register that can appeal to the average educated reader.
Right.
And this is something that I have tried in my book on Ghalib, actually. My first book also on Askari, in which I kind of use this term literary modernity. I have tried to come up with a narrative that is not bogged down by too much of that kind of vocabulary that is associated with the high literature or something like that. But I've tried to create, via media, I've tried to create a path that is able to bring along the educated reader into the subject. Talking about the crisscrossing of modernities and in languages, I feel that that is something that is a given. It happens all the time and it has to happen. For example, when Rekhta, that is poetry in Urdu, began to emerge, it was known as Rekhta,
right,
because it was mixed. So it was mixed with all the languages, you know. In the south, it was mixed with Telugu a lot, in Aurangabad and that those regions. In Gujarat, it was mixed with Gujarati. In Punjab, it was mixed with Punjabi. in Rajasthan it was, so the modernities of all those languages, as you're saying, were similar, because after all, what is modernity other than moving from the classical mode to a more accessible mode of communication in terms of language? As long as we were in that stage, we were still more connected with one another. The problems began when the colonial government started splitting languages and confining them into boxes and saying, oh, this is Hindi, this is Gujarati, this is Bengali. Languages are fluid, they flow into one another. And standardization of languages is a good thing, but the kind of standardization that the colonial government was attempting to do had a twofold, it was like a two-edged sword. At one end, they were helping by standardizing language and encouraging dictionaries, but on the other hand, they were also creating these boxes and creating division between the languages. And we still, you know, where do you draw the line between Hindi and Urdu? If the script was not different, you know, you can't really draw the lines. And I think it's many languages were denied their independent status also. And later on, they had to fight for their independent status, which is a good thing. I also learned, it's not something that only happens in our part of the world, you know, because we are very proud of the fact that we have multiple languages, and we were colonized, and then English began to overlay everything. But then if you look at the history of other languages, for example, because I'm close to Persian, I found that there was a lot of resistance in the Persian literati against Arabic, because Arabic was imposed on Persian speakers. They resisted taking the Arabic language completely, but they still took this, they had to take the script. That's how Persian is not written in Avestan or the earlier scripts. It's written in the Arabic, Perso-Arabic script.
So you're right. There is a colonial scheme in the backdrop of this. Standardization became another euphemism later on.
Exactly. Yeah.
But there is a perpetuity of this logic, and therefore we find that within history, within the way we do history, we are told that there is this medieval history, and only certain kind of scholars who do medieval history, they will look at some of these kind of materials. Those who do ancient history will look at some other kind of materials. I mean, if one has to explore vernacular modernity, how can one abide by this kind of compartmentalization within history? Then understanding of vernacular history, vernacular modernity will be compromised.
Because vernacular also means the history of the common person, right? Who is associated with that, with the language, the speaker of the language. And spoken language has its own place in the culture. And I found that, one of the reasons why I was able to establish or get a footing in the Western academia was that my range was wide. Coming from India, my education and my range was wide. My specialization was not micro, it was macro. And I was able to, and that's one thing that we have, all of us, you, the two of you, you know, we share that. We are coming from a culture which is inclusive, whatever the other side might have to say about it, but it is an inclusive culture. I knew a lot about the stories from Mahabharata, Ramayana, I knew it all.
मैं ये जानना चाह रहा था कि ठीक है, हम लोग inclusive culture से हैं, लेकिन within that जो colonial, which started with the colonial powers that hinged upon like with the, in the post-colonial society. So the Shamsur Rahman Farooqi sahab was an exception ki he could have written books in English, he could have written Kahi Chaand Sari Aasman in English, and he wrote that later. But he decided to write it in Urdu, and he always told people like, if you can read Urdu, please read it in Urdu. So this like multi-personality, unke paas bhasha ka itna samrajya tha. Nowadays, I don't find many people who feel proud like I can write in Hindi. Like this is like, ठीक है, मैं मतलब मैं हिंदी में लिख लेता हूँ, and that's the whole globalized में जब ये channels आए तो हिंदी का चूंकि market हुआ तो लोगों ने हिंदी बोलना शुरू किया. I remember in 90s when I started my journalism, पीपल लाइक बरखा दत्त और राजदीप सरदेसाई, दे डिडंट वांट टू स्पीक इन हिंदी, दे फेल्ट लाइक व्हाई शुड आई स्पीक इन हिंदी, दैट इज चेंज्ड. बट विद इन हिंदी एंड उर्दू कम्युनिटीज देर इज स्टिल आई डोंट फाइंड दैट काइंड ऑफ एक्सेप्टेंस about the Urdu literature. So in the Hindi departments of like even JNU, people will not tell students to read Manjoor Ehtesam or Shamsur Rahman Farooqi or other Urdu authors who are like big authors. I don't know about what happens in Urdu departments, but I find it amazing in the language department that they do not want to read the world literature in the way they should read it. Even the professors from JNU, they don't read like, oh, Marquez is Spanish, we don't need it. Then how do you see the growth of languages or this whole idea of modernity in future? Because you've done translations, and then translations have their own kind of politics.
Right.
How do you see like that future?
Yeah, that's a very good question. And I have been thinking about it because like you, I'm associated with multiple languages. So one of the things that I have found is that canonization seems to happen only when you appear in English.
Exactly. So,
there is a certain kind of, English has become a touchstone, not only for post-colonial cultures like ours, but also all over the world, because English has hogged now the status of a world language. And if you look at so-called category of world literature, it is only those who are available in English get a spot in the world literature. And this thing began when Salman Rushdie produced his anthology. I forget which year it was. It was called Mirror Work.
Yeah, 97, 50 years of independence.
Right, most of the...
that was criticized big time.
It was, but it is nonetheless, it points to a certain tendency.
Yes, yes.
The canon formation, the canonization only happened in English. You can have a canon in Hindi and a canon in Urdu and in your own regional languages, but it's only when you appear, like even for such a great writer like my father, only when his novel appeared in English did it become a, you know, like an internationally renowned novel. When it was in Urdu, it was published, it went through like two editions, but once it appeared in English, it's now gone through multiple editions and also in Hindi. So who is to blame for this? It's too big of a monster for us to tame, you know. We can only do our own bit by sticking to our language. And at the same time, being open to, you know, we have to continue our tradition of multilingualism. I can tell you, I was working on Abdul Rahim Khanekhana, and not because of my own choice, but there was, his tomb was being, restored in Delhi, and there was a big conference organized around him. And so I was asked to do a paper on Rahim. And I was shocked to find out that he was a polyglot. He knew, like, I don't know how many languages, and he composed in Hindi, you know, Rahim ke Dohe, he composed in Persian, he composed in Turki, he composed in dialects. So our tradition has been to be multilingual and not shy away from writing in more than one language. And I'm so happy that, you know, you have also been doing this, writing in Hindi and writing in English. You know, there shouldn't be this politics or hierarchy, but unfortunately there is. Of course, there is a hierarchy of languages.
Yes.
And translation also sticks to that hierarchy. So unless you are translated into English, it's not going to bring you into the center of the world literature. You may be translated into many other languages.
To add to that politics of hierarchy, there is also this politics of purity. So purest form of Hindi, purest form of Urdu, purest form of, I mean, it's such a difficult thing to penetrate into, break free from.
So we just use the words that are available to us from our own languages, you know. If there is a word that fits from Bangla, I mean, look at English. English has so much vocabulary from all the languages, right? From German, from French, from Spanish, यू नेम इट, दे हैव टेकन इट फ्रॉम आर ओन, फ्रॉम हिंदी उर्दू. इफ यू लुक एट द ओईडी, देयर सो मेनी, देयर इज अ लॉन्ग लिस्ट ऑफ वोकैबुलरी दैट दे हैव टेकन फ्रॉम अस. सो व्हाई नॉट, यू नो, व्हाई शुड वी फील शाय अबाउट इट. आई थिंक दिस शुड बी प्रमोटेड इन अ बिग वे. माय फादर ऑफ कोर्स वाज a big supporter of this thing. He would say that apni zabano mein se jab words hai to usko kyun nahi le rahe bhai, lijiye.
So do you think in a way this whole thing that you have talked about gives us material to frame certain kind of antithesis to the very celebrated thesis of Sheldon Pollock? For Sheldon Pollock, the ordinary usages of literature, poetry, language doesn't matter until Kavya is clearly in relation with Raj. So the power of the relation of power and literature is the premise for him to give this idea of, you know, linguistic cosmopolis. What we are discussing here gives us a different sense of cosmopolis. It's not necessarily cosmopolis in which literature would be essentially connected with the power to be.
I completely agree with you. And let me give you again, fall back on Ghalib. So what Ghalib did was that first he started writing in Urdu. Then he started writing in Persian. For 20 years, he didn't write in Urdu. He only wrote in Persian because he felt that Urdu's range is only confined to the Indian subcontinent and Persian's range is beyond that. And then he became associated with the royal court, and Bahadur Shah Zafar was writing only in Urdu, so he had to go back to writing in Urdu. And that was, those were his last years, so he produced a little bit more in Urdu. But you know, in the end, what happened? His fame rests on Urdu. It doesn't, nobody recognizes him in Farsi. Most people don't even know that he composed in Farsi. Whereas his Farsi compositions are 5 times more than his Urdu compositions. But his fame actually rests on that vernacular divan. So the power of the middle languages is very profound, and it can't be ignored. We have to move along with those, with that, and the fact that what exactly is the medium of communicating your ideas to your listener and to your reader. And that is something that is important.
But I just want to share two simple anecdotes. One is, like, I'm thinking about Kabir. Like, we know that Kabir wrote in Banaras, but they're like, Kabir ke dohes in Malwa, in Rajasthan, in Gujarat, and like language totally different. And when you listen to these things, like, you may or may not know all the words, but you feel that, you know, this how the doha is changing with the areas, and they have made it their own. So I find that kind of modernity in the Indian languages as well, and we can pick up easy, like we can pick up something from Malwa and add it to it. But Hindi is not doing that. That I know for sure. Like, people make fun of, like, if someone is writing on social media, make fun of. On the other hand, in one of the professors in my department, Mary Jo Bang, she had translated Dante in a contemporary English,
I see.
Which is like in the way of, like, she wanted to sing Dante in a hip-hop manner. Mm-hmm. Can we think of doing Ramcharitmanas in English in a hip-hop way? Or even in Hindi? So, like, because the rhyme is there, everything is there. But if I talk to some Hindi, like, literary figure, I want to do Ramcharitmanas in a hip-hop way, they will be like, this guy has gone mad. So that kind of experimentation, is it lacking in India? And if it is lacking, what are the reasons you see? Because you have lived in West, you have seen these kind of experimentation in Western literature. So what that thing is happening? Why we are, like, so inclined? And once we come to the West, we know, like, yaar, Hindi mein bhi bahut hai, Urdu mein bhi bahut hai. Lekin jab hum India mein rehte hain, toh lagta hai ki yaar, sab kuch angrezi mein, Salman Rushdie se bada koi lekhak hi nahi hai. So, like, theek hai, post-colonialism hai, but why? Matlab, I'm just trying to understand.
To add to that, can we imagine Gully Boys singing Mirza Ghalib today?
For your information, I recently, somebody forwarded me a rap in ghalib, ghalib being sung in rap, and I can send it to you.
How wonderful.
It is, I post, if you follow me on Twitter, I posted it on Twitter, and it is, this person has done har ek baat pe kehte ho tum ki tu kya hai, tum hi kaho kitne andaaze guftugu kya hai, you know, he's wrapped it. And there are people who are saying, how dare you do this, how dare you do that, but there are people who are applauding it also. So Ghalib is now in rap, Iqbal is in rap. We are breaking the stereotypes. We are breaking the stereotypes. And Sting was mostly colonial, you know, it was inspired by the British and they installed it. So we passed through that kind of indoctrination that the teacher is always right, you know, you have to do it like this, the jo bata diya wahi hai usko sahi hai, lekin ab I think we are breaking out of it, we are breaking out of it.
But the Puritans who control the discourses, they would have nightmares and they would not leave any stone unturned to stop it or regulate it.
That is true, I guess, but because there's one advantage with the internet, that you have so many platforms now, and it has really opened up creativity, the avenues in which, through which creativity can be expressed. Very early on, we started doing illustrations of poetry, and this was something pretty new, which began in the 1930s. And now we are doing all these. I mean, before that also, hum log ki jo miniature paintings thi na, ragni ke upar, rag mala ke upar, to music ko kis tarah art mein, ye sari cheezon mein hum log bahut aage the. Ye hum log pata nahi beech mein ek aisa phase aaya ki hum pata nahi kaun se janjal mein phans gaye, lekin hum ab usse nikal rahe hain.
लोगों
ने अपने सिस्टम में अपना ही लिटरेचर नहीं पढ़ा.
Exactly.
ये बहुत बड़ा फ्लॉ है. अगर हमें पहले से ये सब पढ़ाया गया होता तो आज हम उससे कब का, मतलब जो आप कह रहे हैं कि रैप या ये सब हम लोग कर रहे होते हैं और ज्यादा वे में. तो अब शायद इसको थोड़ा बहुत शायद कोशिश की गई थी बीच में थोड़ा करने के, लेकिन अब तो पता नहीं क्या होगा. खैर एनीवे,
मेरा ये सवाल था कि फारूकी साहब के जाने के बाद आपने भी और आपकी बहन ने भी जो पीसेस लिखे, उनका इतना बड़ा काम है, मतलब लिटरेरी फिगर है, सब कुछ है, लेकिन जब आप लोगों ने उनको याद किया तो बहुत छोटी छोटी चीजों से याद किया. मुझे जो बड़ी याद है, मुझे नहीं एग्जैक्टली पता किसने लिखा है, लेकिन कि वो पाइप पीते थे, वो पाइप को साफ करने के बड़े सारे यंत्र उनके पास होते थे, या उनका चश्मा था.
बहुत अच्छा उसने ट्रांसलेशन किया था.
हाँ, कि उनका चश्मा था या उनका एक कोट था जो वो आए थे अमेरिका से लेके. मेरा ये सवाल है कि जब हम एक बड़े लिटरेरी फिगर को या किसी को भी जब हम मेमोरी में याद करते हैं, या जैसे आपने भी कहा कि भाई गालिब आपको याद थे बचपन में कुछ शेर, तो आपने पीएचडी किया उस पे, या उस पे लिखने की आपने जरूरत महसूस की, तो ये जो मेमोरी है वो लिटरेचर में कैसे प्ले करता है? और जब हम जब लोगों को याद करते हैं तो क्या वो मेमोरी का जो छोटा सा हिस्सा है, हाउ टू एम्प्लीफाई दैट स्मॉल पार्ट कॉल्ड मेमोरी इन सम वेज इन द लिटरेचर?
आई थिंक मेमोरी इज यूजुअली इन फ्रैगमेंट्स. देयर आर सर्टेन फ्रैगमेंट्स दैट स्टिक विद अस मोर देन अदर्स. जिस जमाने में वो पाइप पीते थे, वो सिगरेट भी पीते थे, लेकिन पाइप ज्यादा समहाउ दैट फ्रैगमेंट. हालांकि मैंने उनके सिगरेट पीने के बारे में भी, आई हैव रिटन अबाउट इट, ही यूज्ड टू ब्लो रिंग्स इन द एयर, यू नो, फॉर मी. एंड अक्सर वो सिगरेट उनके हाथ में रहता था, वो एकदम नीचे जलने तक आ जाता था, उनके हाथ में दोनों निशान थे. ये सारी चीजें मुझे याद हैं. तो मैंने असल में उन पे मैंने दो तीन मजमून जल्दी जल्दी लिखे उस, बिकॉज गम को वो करने के लिए, शेयर करने से, वो राइटिंग के थ्रू ना, तो उससे मुझे बहुत मदद मिली. बट टू गेट बैक टू योर क्वेश्चन, आई थिंक ऑब्वियसली मेमोरी प्लेज अ वेरी इंपॉर्टेंट रोल इन रिट्रीविंग द पास्ट, बट वी ऑलवेज रिट्रीव इट इन फ्रैक्शंस एंड बिट्स, वी नेवर रिट्रीव इट एज अ होल. सो दैट्स व्हाट, यू नो, वी रिट्रीव इट एज अ कोलाज. of different fragments and then we put it together. We can't really come, there is not a complete recall of everything. I think that is what makes it also very poignant, because those pieces that we recall are so important to us and they strike something in our minds and our memories. So that's why I think that's how it happens. I'm actually writing a memoir of his, of my
To
father.
ask about the contestation within Urdu literary sphere, contestation of various stakeholders, how to
Well, I think
identify.
so. One of the things was that because he was in the civil services, for a long time he had to suffer a lot of discrimination from the Urdu literary sphere, because they said, "अरे वो तो सरकारी नौकर हैं, उन्हें क्या पता, उन्होंने कहाँ पढ़ाया है, उन्हें क्या मालूम." So I must say that my mother's contribution also was very big in this, because she supported him and she gave him so much space to do whatever he wanted to do. Because उनकी ये नहीं रहती थी कि भाई आज आप हमें डिनर पे ले चलिए, या लेट्स गो एंड सी सिनेमा. वो शी अलाउड हिम all this luxury of working all the time, holding a full time civil services job and then doing this. And then when he started this magazine Shapkhun, she was the one who gave the financial support and kept supporting it for at least 10 years until it became self reliant. So she played a very, very important role in his trajectory as an important writer. But I know that there were people in the Urdu world, वही लोग with whom he had built, whose reputation was owed to him, whom he had published in Shapkun, whom he had patted on the head, on the back, and said, हाँ, बहुत अच्छा लिख रहे हो. Those were the people who, when they became established, they started backbiting. Although इतनी बड़ी हस्ती को कौन कितना भी backbite करे, I mean, he transcended all that. He didn't really hold it
I
against him.
thought I should draw your attention to a particular kind of woeful narrative I hear from some of the established thinkers, जो हिंदी के बारे में चिंता करने वाले लोग हैं. They usually talk of the poverty of Hindi today, looking at Hindi media, looking at the politically, socially irresponsible scholars in Hindi studies. Likewise, how do you reflect on the scholars who are doing Urdu literature or Urdu in regard to Urdu media? How do you look at the condition of Urdu today?
See, I think Urdu media is really in a bad place, because I was associated with a project with Wikipedia, and we were looking at the Wikipedia in the different languages of India, and I found that it was very good in Bangla. It was pretty okay in Gujarati, and not too bad in Hindi and Telugu, but it was very bad in Urdu. Also, Urdu newspapers. I think there are a couple of newspapers that come out from Hyderabad that are reasonably okay. But generally speaking, what they are reduced to is just translating the stories from the English version of their thing. But having said that, I feel that recently there has been interest in Urdu as a language that is, once again, like Hindustani, a language of communication, a language of poetry. Because after all, why does poetry touch us more than prose? अगर आप इस सवाल को पूछिए, poetry is something that goes directly, appeals to us. It is concise and the language is very heightened. So as long as Urdu has that heightened repertoire of poetry, it is a direct communication with the listeners and the readers. I mean, people always want to stop, and aaj bhi people, when they give speeches, they always fall back on Urdu poetry, for quoting. But having said that, I also think that across the border in Pakistan, I feel Urdu is struggling with English, but it is still able to hold its own a little bit, at least in terms of what I see being written in short fiction, in even in novels. There have been some fresh blood, and these are people who have spent some part of their career overseas and have gone back to Pakistan or India, and who are now using that enhanced or enriched experience and pouring it into the language. So there are people like that who are emerging, and so I don't see it. I don't see a very bleak future. Certainly, they need to. I mean, you know, there's already this divide between English and the rest of the world. In terms of media reporting, also, English is ahead of us because they have the means. I feel that in Hindi, in India, I think there is a certain prejudice associated with it. People feel that the Hindi reporter is not smart enough, is not modern enough, or something like that. I mean, these are just prejudices. They have been broken by people like Ravish Kumar, for example.
Yes.
He is one of my icons. As long as there are people like him, like Udayan Bajpai, Ashok Bajpai, even though these people are not full-time professionals in Hindi, of course Ashok ji is. So there are, I think there is, as long as even there are a couple of people, I would say, who are doing good work in the language, it doesn't take much for a revival to happen. We are seeing, for example, Rekhta. It started as a very small festival. Now it is a huge, not only a huge festival, but it's a huge website. Now they are producing programs. So I think with Rekhta, which is kind of a softer version of Urdu, but why not accept that, you know, as aise aapne kaha ki hip hop ya bhai jo popular culture hai usko hum we cannot turn away from it.
बिल्कुल बिल्कुल
We cannot keep sitting on our high horse and say, okay, ये सब
बिल्कुल
तो हम से नीचे हैं, ये सब जमीन पर कीड़े चल रहे हैं, हम तो घोड़े पर बैठे हैं. ऐसा कैसे हो सकता है? तो